Welcome to the state capitol, Albany, New York. This marketplace in New York State was being taken advantage of without regulation. Shovel-ready construction projects, education, health care. We have to do everything humanly possible as legislators to make it a fair and more equal society.
Hi, you're watching Capitol Report with Senator Neil Breslin. I'm Julia Lilkindy, and I'll be your host as your state senator and I discuss what's going on in the New York State Senate. How are you, Senator?
I'm terrific, Julia. How are you?
Good. It's great to see you.
Good to see you.
As the Senate Insurance Committee Chairman, what are your priorities?
Well, we could go on for days talking about the priorities, but there's several that are critically important. The first thing is to watch your health insurance premiums, and we're going to do everything in our power this year to lower them through having the health maintenance organizations do more to show they need increases. We're going to work on autism legislation, and we'll talk about that in a moment. And there's several other issues as well we'll get into.
Right. I want to talk to you about medical malpractice, because I know that is definitely one of your priorities. Where does New York stand compared to other states with regard to medical liability premiums that doctors and hospitals pay?
Well, Julia, I'd love to tell you we stand first in good categories. In this case, we don't. There are the most medical malpractice verdicts that come out of New York, the highest level of verdicts come out of New York, and doctors are paying exorbitant rates for medical malpractice insurance. In some cases, down in Long Island, OBGYN doctors are paying just under $200,000 for medical malpractice insurance, and it's driving doctors to go to other states. So it's our objective this year to reduce medical malpractice rates, to increase a greater number of insurance companies that will be willing to take care of doctors, and also to make sure that the doctors who perform services in New York State are graded and evaluated so that we weed out doctors who shouldn't be practicing.
Right. So does the legal system need to be more efficient as it relates to medical malpractice claims?
It really does. In that case, you'll find that if someone sues for malpractice, it takes, on the average, 5 years to complete a case. That's unacceptable. In addition, the costs involved to insurance companies, over 60% of the dollars don't go to someone who is a victim of malpractice. 60% of the costs are transactional. It's for the cost of the lawsuit, and that's way too much. So we have to streamline the system. And I'd also add there's a great number of people who are victims of malpractice who never sue. But we have to make sure everyone's protected at the least possible cost and that we expedite the process.
Right. How important is it to create a more competitive environment to bring medical liability insurers to New York State?
Well, if you have one or two insurance companies who are selling medical malpractice insurance, then there's not good competition and they can raise their rates disproportionately. If we have five or six good carriers, they're going to compete against each other, and they're going to give the medical profession the lowest possible rate.
As the Senate Insurance Chairman, you've led hearings to get public input about medical malpractice. And let's cut to your opening and closing remarks from your last medical malpractice hearing.
I might add that the malpractice situation has been a crisis, not of the last year or the last 5 or 10 years, but it's really been a crisis that has existed for really going on a half century, and I mean that literally. And we have to look for ways to control the costs of medical malpractice insurance and set a market that everybody can accept. To review all the different areas in a comprehensive and complete way, to resolve and get to a point where the medical profession, the hospitals, the insured, the legal community, everyone can be satisfied that we have a credible system. And we will refuse this year to accept anything other than a resolution of the issues that are before us. Not to use sports metaphors, but the old saying, if you have the will to win, you will win. And we promise you to explore every possibility to come to a resolution that everyone and this audience will be happy with. In conclusion, I think we received a lot of wonderful material. As I indicated before, we have every expectation of being able to come to a resolution on the medical malpractice issue in the coming months. And I know I speak for Senator Schneiderman and Senator Duane that I'm sure others, since the beginning of the crisis, somewhere in the early 1970s, have said the same thing. But we have every intention of making this real. And I appreciate everyone who's stuck out this very long day. We look forward to hearing from you with additional testimony. And I'm sure that you look forward to us from getting back to you with substantive legislation.
Now, I want to move on to another one of your priorities. You talked about autism. And I understand that there was a public hearing on the role of health insurance in the diagnosis and treatment of autism spectrum disorder.
Right.
What brought about that hearing?
Well, as you read in the paper and a lot of people tuning in, autism a number of years ago when I first got to the Senate was not talked about a great deal. And there were statistics saying that 1 in 300 children had a spectrum disorder, autism, and then that began to gradually come down to 1 in 166, I remember, 1 in 150, down to 1 in 110, and now under 1 in 100. And we're still not sure of a lot of the causes of autism, but parents of autistic children would like to see insurance coverage, and we want to make sure that if there's coverage, that it's done in the most expedient way possible. And maybe expedient isn't the correct word, but that the coverage is targeted to the proper care of a child with autism.
What kind of testimony did you hear at that hearing?
It was compelling testimony, but it's still such a new area that there are a lot of different methods to treat autism, and there's lots of different kinds of autism. And it's not just a very simple problem with a very clear solution. It's a problem with many solutions. So we're trying to put together legislation that would put autism as a mandate on insurance coverage. There are certain things that in New York State that you put on your insurance policy and they're covered by the insurance. Other things aren't. But we want to make sure that we keep it directed to the major treatments for autism. Because if you drive up insurance costs by 1% in the state of New York, so if you have a policy and there's a 1% increase, you drive over 30,000 people away from health insurance. So you just can't look at it as one problem. It's very much three-dimensional.
On the topic of prior approval, the cost of health insurance has become a major concern for families. The words prior approval have special meaning. Can you tell me your thoughts on that?
They sure do. Prior approval since the middle of the 1990s has meant that a health maintenance organization, what you call an HMO, many people who are looking at us, they have health insurance and they pay bills every month and they're going up on a yearly basis, sometimes by double digits. In part, that's because the health maintenance organizations are able to file for a rate increase at the Department of Insurance and receive it without any review. And that's called file and use. I feel very strongly that that should not be the way that we do business in the state of New York, that if an HMO wants an increase in their rates, they should apply for it and justify it, and that means prior approval. So we've been working on legislation which would call for a prior approval by the insurance department of any rate increase. And if it's a significant rate increase, if you get the 10% rate increase, there should be a hearing. And we should discuss the issues openly to make sure that those HMOs justify it. Because if you're a business, whether you're profit or not for profit, and you know you can have a rate increase just by filing a paper, it seems to me you might be encouraged to just do it to get it.
Yeah, so how exactly will it make it insurance more affordable?
Well, to make it more affordable, because we'll be, the insurance department will be analyzing each request for a rate increase. And if there's a justification, the rate increase will be granted. If there's not, it'll be denied. And it will tighten up the process and make insurance companies, the HMOs, much more accountable to the public.
Other than your insurance priorities, what are some other things that you really want to strive for this year?
Well, if we had 2 days, I'd be able to name them all. There's a lot to do with campaign finance reform. People in the legislature receive campaign contributions, and they should be open to the public. There's now been set up some defense funds by legislators that they're alleging are not open to the public. I have legislation which would make every dime contributed by anyone to a legislator open to review by the public. Also, there are legislators who pass away, whether they're in office or out of office, and they leave these enormous funds, campaign funds, and spouses or relatives are distributing those monies as they see fit. I think that's unacceptable. I think we have to, and I've introduced legislation to say if the case arises where someone passes away, that their funds do not go to their relatives for use. And there's other bills that are more local in nature. I can think of one relating with the city of Albany, and that's the Albany Parking Permit Bill. And that would allow people who live in and around the Capitol, where a lot of the legislators and their staffs park and disrupt the lives of people who have residence in those neighborhoods, because there aren't garages. Those houses were built in the 19th century. And so this would give a homeowner or a renter the ability to park in front of their house. I think it's time we do it. That legislation has been in the offering for over 12 years. I think this is the year to pass it. In addition, we have to look for ways to address, to me, the two major issues in the state of New York: the overtaxation, particularly with property taxes, and the lack of jobs. So in upstate New York, we really have to strive for economic development, to look for ways that we can infuse low-interest loans or grants to small companies from 1 to 5 people so that they can start businesses and then maybe get tax credits if they add on employees. And we must, this session, despite the economic turmoil, look for some sort of real property tax relief. Now, if you own a house and you're a young couple and you're just starting out and you have tax increases, you can't afford that. If you're a retired couple and you've been living in your house for 25 years and you retire, you know what you're going to need in order to survive and get by in your retirement age. And then you see 10 and 12 and 15% increases in your school taxes and your property taxes. Those people have to have relief, and it's up to us as legislators to work on that on a day-in, day-out basis to make sure we have tax relief, and that ties into jobs. If we create those new jobs, that means that people are paying taxes, they're going into the stores, and it's going to enhance our economy, and it's going to reduce and assist us in our ability to lower property taxes.
Great. What was, very quickly, we only have 1 minute, what was your reaction to the governor's budget proposal for this upcoming year?
Well, I was encouraged that there was less than 1% increase in spending. We have to look for ways, and unfortunately, we have to look to health care and education. Education and health care represent over 60% of the budget. That's where we have to reduce spending. And that's going to hurt our local schools. So if we cut our local schools, we got to make sure that it's the ones that can afford the cuts so that they won't be raising taxes. You know, every choice we make has implications, and those implications in some cases can be dire. So we have to look for the cuts in health care and education, but make sure they're the proper ones that don't raise taxes.
Great. Thank you so much, Senator.
Julia, it's been a delight. Look forward to seeing you again.
You too. For any additional information, breslin.nysenate.gov.